honored and blessed here in the city and in the chapter to have our dear guest, Dr. Jasser Ouda, with us today. He'll be, as you guys know, giving his a talk today, and he'll be giving the khutbah tomorrow, inshallah, in Jummah. Professor Dr. Jasser Ouda is a scholar of Islamic legal theory, especially in the area of higher purposes or maqasid of the Islamic law. He's the president of Maqasid Institute Global, a think tank registered in the USA, UK, Malaysia, and Indonesia. He's a visiting professor at the Center for the Study of Islam at Carleton University, Canada, currently. And he's a visiting professor at the Rule of Law Institute Faculty of Law, Loyola University in Chicago. And Al-Shatibi Chair for Maqasid Studies at the International Peace University in South Africa. All of these mentions are his current roles. He has a long list of previous roles he has played internationally, mashallah. And so we are blessed to have someone with his caliber and his knowledge and his expertise with us today. So jazakumullah khair for coming, Dr. Jasser, and for being with us today.
Allah khair. Jazakumullah khair. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Wa salatu wa salamu ala as'adi khalqihi wa khatam rusulihi Muhammad. Sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa tabi'in. Wa man tabi'ahum bi ihsanin ila yawm al-deen. Thumma amma ba'd. It's such a blessing to be back to London, Ontario. Last time I was here, 10 years ago, yeah. So it's been a long time. I spent my 90s mostly in Waterloo, that's why people from Waterloo know me very well. They were much younger at that time, but they would know me from that time. So from London, from Waterloo, I would come to London, Ontario sometimes. Sometimes to give khutbahs, I remember at some point you had a gap for an imam back in the back in the mosque. I don't remember where it is now. That long street,
Oxford
Street.
20,
okay,
20 years now, ago.
That's 20 years ago. Yeah. So that's how old we are. it's a great city. It's a very interesting city. It has a lot of potential for many great projects and great minds, mashallah. So alhamdulillah, to be back. Assalamu alaikum to each and every one of you. The talk is actually about the Quran. My brothers and sisters asked me to talk about the Quran since it is the month of Ramadan, which is the celebration of the Quran. I would like to give a kind of a different talk from the usual talk, though, about the Quran and how it was revealed, etc., and the history of it, to a more serious topic about the culture of the Quran and what it means to read the Quran and how, as Muslims, we actually deviated from the Quranic way of life. And the Quranic concepts and the Quranic way of dealing with issues. I would say the Quranic way of even defining the issues. I think there's been a gap that started after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has passed, and his khulafa had kept this gap as small as they can. The gap between the Muslim life and what the Quran says about the Muslim life. And then eventually there was an angle between how we practiced Islam and how we understood it, and how we understood especially the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which according to the Quran is supposed to be a bayan of the Quran. وَأَنْزَلْنَا إِلَيْكَ الذِّكْرَ لِتُبَيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِ مَا نُزِّلَ إِلَيْهِمْ. So the Sunnah is supposed to be a bayan of the Quran, an illustration. بَيَانَ يُبَيِّنُ is to illustrate, is to give more details and so on. Into developing the Sunnah to become even different from the Quran. and in some of its narrations even contradictory to the Quran. And that is sometimes due to a misnarration of some of the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And of course there was a whole wave of what's called wadu al-hadith, you know, the lying about the hadith, especially after the time of the fitna and so on, and the division of Muslims into sects, etc. And a misinterpretation of the hadith. So even some of the hadith that are actually authentic, they were misinterpreted, they were taken out of the context of the rest of the hadith and the Quran. And then eventually we entered into a different stage of schools of Islamic thought in terms of, we started with Ahlul Ra'i and Ahlul Athar, the people of opinion and the people of narration. And the people of opinion would say that because there is so much lying about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam at some point, so we have to use our minds and we have to use our opinion. And yes, they read the Quran, but they did not apply the Quran in the methodology of the opinion. The opinion was about what's called in the usul i'mal al-aql, or using the mind. And what the Hanafis eventually, that school that was originally a school of opinion, that they called istihsan, which is a form of i'mal al-maslaha, or to think in terms of the best interest of the people and so forth. But then Ahlul Athar said, or the people of the narration, they said, we are going to apply the narration, any narration that is relevant to the question that we have, even if it's a weak narration. So they did not really care about the authentication of narrations. You know, the school of Imam Ahmad and so on, before he would do any qiyas or analogy or any of these things, he would look for the narrations, even the weak narrations that are narrated by people who are not that good in terms of memory or trustworthiness. And then we got deviated to a culture that was shaped by the narrations, whether the authentic ones, which are very few, you're talking about 1,000 narrations maximum that are really authentically connected to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I'm talking if you eliminate all the repetitions. And many narrations that were misinterpreted or misunderstood. And we started to deviate from that time from the Quran and what it says and what it's supposed to be asking us to do. And eventually fiqh was developed within the window that the state allowed from the year 40, when the Khilafah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or the succession of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, was translated into what's called al-mulk, what the Prophet called sallallahu alaihi wasallam, al-mulk al-adud, or the greedy kingdom, even though it continued to be called Khilafah and continued to maintain a form of unity of Muslims until 20th century, and you know the history. But the Khilafah from 40 Hijri did not allow al-fiqh to expand beyond the ibadat, beyond what we know now as Islam, really, you know, tahara, salah, zakah, al-hajj, and so forth, and some issues related to the family law, and a few issues related to trade and so on, but nothing beyond that. From 40, maximum 60, 70 Hijri, if you are really tolerant with what happened from 40 Hijri, you are talking about a fiqh that has nothing to do with the public manifestation and the public practice of Islam, and how the civilization itself has developed under many influences, and how this fiqh has deviated from what the Quran is talking about. in terms of government, in terms of society. And yes, there were courts that referred to the Sharia that we had until the colonial times, which kept a form of Islamic rules into especially the family law and parts in the criminal law and so forth. But the rest of the law, let alone the rest of life, was developed more or less in a secular way, more or less with the guidance, the very general guidance of the Islamic values, but not really in terms of the Quran. We developed a whole system of trade and a whole system of art and architecture and a whole system of government and administration and so on, and education, that related to the Quran in occasionally, really, rather than something that were built on Quranic terminology or Quranic concepts, or how the Quran defines the Muslim life. And I will explain some of the details in that as we talk about the Quran then. That might sound quite harsh for those who are not familiar with this kind of topic, because we have a perception that the Quran is general, but then fiqh is specific and practical. And that if you refer to the Quran, and as some scholars even say these days, you are referring to generic statements. You're referring to a very loose framework. But if you ask a faqih a question that you have, then the faqih is going to give you a particular answer. And that perception is actually inaccurate, because when you ask a faqih, you're asking about mostly a moral issue. You have an issue, you are going to a doctor, and you're not sure whether the doctor should see your awra or not. So you go and ask a faqih about the awrat, and whether the doctor could see that awra or not, and there is the debate, and so forth. But what medicine is about, and the philosophy upon which medicine is formed, is actually secular, is not Quranic. It doesn't define the human being as the Quran defines it. The Quran defines the human as body, al-jasad, al-qayna al-kursiyi, jasadan, and al-nafs, a soul, and al-ruh, the spirit, let's say. The body is defined as a machine. It's not defined as jasad wa nafs wa ruh. And when we deal with the nafs, with the branch of knowledge that we call psychology today, we don't deal with the nafs as the Quran described it. We deal with the nafs as Freud described it, really. But then we superimpose on Freud some of the Islamic reflections, or some of the ways how we can deal with a nafs in an Islamic way. When we deal with the economics, we don't define the system as the Quran defined it. We define economics as capitalist economics. Is capitalist economics necessarily haram? No, it's not like that, but there are elements in the capitalist system that are un-Islamic. Do we have a theory for economics beyond Islamic finance? No, we don't. We when we do Islamic economics, or when you go and study and get a degree in Islamic economics these days, you get a degree in Islamic finance. So basically you are superimposing the Islamic moral system on the capitalist system. Just trying to get a mortgage, but you want to call it rent, really, instead of mortgage. You want to get the same car, but you are going to call it installment payments, not interest. But the bank is not a car dealer, and the bank is not a broker. The bank, the Islamic bank, I mean, is selling you money, really, because it is not the job of the bank to deal in cars, and the bank might not even see the car. And if they take some precautions, they will bring the car to the basement of the bank and then resell the car to you in installments. But before you leave, you pay the 100, that's the price of the car, plus the 20 or 30, that is the installments addition. And the bank basically takes its money before you leave. But the bank is not a car dealer. And the bank is not a real estate developer. But the bank works in this because, I'm talking about the Islamic bank, is actually trading in money. It's a broker, but it's lending you as well. So it's a mixture. I'm not judging whether this is right or wrong, but I'm saying it's wrong in terms of creativity, in terms of the potential of Islam to create other models other than the models that we have today, the usual democratic model for governance that has many flaws. Yes, it's much better than dictatorship, but it has many flaws and we're not developing it. The Muslim movements are dying for the sake of democracy, really. They believe that democracy is a goal, but democracy is supposed to be a tool and not something to die for from an Islamic point of view. And we are fighting in terms of trying to bring the Islamic finance system. But the Islamic finance system is part and parcel of the capitalist system, of the bigger system. And we're not really challenging the injustices that are built in the capitalist system. And yes, this is a long shot and dangerous talk. But as Muslims, at least we have to have a vision to try to really make a change in the system. And because we are not making a change in the system from a Quranic perspective, we are hijacked even before we start our Islamic project, because we don't have a non-tyrannical and non-democratic way of imagining a state. Our project, our political project, is hijacked. Because you are practicing a mixture of tyranny and democracy, but you're not really going beyond that into an Islamic system of shura that the Islamic thought has developed quite a bit over the past century. There's a lot of writings, a lot of research on shura, but that is not really part and parcel of an Islamic movement's agenda. And there is a lot of talk about Islamic economics and how we can reimagine new ways of doing even finances and so forth based on awqaf, endowments, and based on other forms of investment and so forth. But the bank will have to take some risks. So the Islamic bank doesn't want to take risks because it is trading in money. So therefore, we really are not doing a difference. And any of this have to do with the Quran? It has everything to do with how we read the Quran. Because when we read the Quran, it will redefine our conceptual framework of the world. It will take us from any other philosophy. And it doesn't mean to reject every other philosophy, but to take from every other philosophy and every other system with awareness what you are taking and what you are rejecting. Now, when you start reading the Quran, you know Arabic, let's assume, and you don't know what the Quran is about. And you start to open the Quran and read, since this is the month when the Quran is revealed, you will see a very strange language there, if you know Arabic very well, but you don't know the Quranic Arabic. You open and you say, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. Praise to Allah, the Lord of the worlds. Al Alameen. Of course, Ar Rahman, Ar Rahim are not exactly forms of Rahmah that the Arabs used, but there are two forms of Rahmah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But then Al Alameen, what is that? The Arabs knew al-alam, and has to do with ilm. So your knowledge of something will create a domain of knowledge, alam. But, and even today we say al-alam for the world. But al-alamin, for the world, that is a new concept. But then eventually, as you read, the Quran will show you and open up those alameen for you, will explain what it means by that. Malik Yawm al-Din, even if you know that Yawm al-Din is Yawm al-Hisab, the day of judgment, the day of resurrection, you are not going to know what this is unless you start to continue reading, and then it will start to give you the details. So basically, the Quran is doing tafsir to itself as you go. This is the Quranic reading, the real Quranic reading. And this is how the Prophet ﷺ taught the Quran. He taught the Quran not from his own whims. He taught the Quran from the Quran. So when he is asked about something in Al-An'am, he explains with Luqman. What was that again? وَعِنْدَهُ مَفَاتِحُ الْغَيْبِ لَا يَعْلَمُهَا إِلَّا هُوَ. He was asked about مَفَاتِحُ الْغَيْبِ. So he went to Surah Luqman. إِنَّ اللَّهَ عِنْدَهُ عِلْمُ السَّاعَةِ وَيُنَزِّلُ الْغَيْثَ وَيَعْلَمُ مَا فِي الْأَرْحَامِ. So he's doing the tafsir with the tafsir. And every time he's asked about the Quran, go survey the couple hundred ahadith in which the Prophet ﷺ, as narrated authentically, talked about the Quran. He's talking about the Quran from the Quran. ذلك الكتاب لا ريب فيه هدى للمتقين. المتقين تقوى يتقي is to protect yourself, or to, but it's not really the concept that is called the taqwa. Taqwa is a major concept, and the Quran is saying from page one that it is the objective of the Quran. Hudan lilmuttaqin. ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ. This is the book, or this is the al-kitab, is the risala, the, you know, the, this is the writ or the message, no doubt about it. In it there is guidance for those who have taqwa. Now taqwa is an objective here, because the book will give you taqwa. Now Ramadan, we are fasting. The objective of Ramadan is also taqwa. يَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الصِّيَامُ كَمَا كُتِبَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ مِن قَبْلِكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. But it's not only the book that's leading to taqwa, and Ramadan leading to taqwa. Even before this ayah, يَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الصِّيَامُ, there is وَلَكُمْ فِي الْقِصَاصِ حَيَاةٌ يَا أُولِي الْأَلْبَابِ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. لَعَلَّ means so for the sake of, so that you can. So qisas, or the system of punishment, or how they say it in English, the rebuttal of a crime, or the deterrence,
retribution.
Thank you. The retribution of a crime. In the Quran is for the sake of taqwa, right? And then you will find a few verses before that. لَيْسَ الْبِرَّ أَن تُوَلُّوا وُجُوهَكُمْ قِبْلَ الْمَشْرِقِ وَالْمَغْرِبِ وَلَكِنَّ الْبِرَّ مَنْ آمَنَ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ وَالْمَلَائِكَةِ وَالْكِتَابِ وَالنَّبِيِّينَ وَآتَى الْمَالَ عَلَى حُبِّهِ وَالْقُرْبَى وَالْيَتَامَى وَالْمَسَاكِينَ وَابْنَ السَّبِيلِ وَالسَّائِلِينَ وَفِي الرِّقَابِ وَأَقَامَ الصَّلَاةَ وَآتَى الزَّكَاةَ وَالْمُوفُونَ بِعَهْدِهِمْ إِذَا عَاهَدُوا وَالصَّابِرِينَ فِي الْبَأْسَاءِ وَالضَّرَّاءِ وَحِينَ الْبَأْسِ أُولَئِكَ الَّذِينَ صَدَقُوا وَأُولَئِكَ هُمُ الْمُتَّقُونَ. So here is another description of التقوى, البر, prayers and zakah, and you know, feeding the hungry and the poor, and this and that, and fulfilling your promises, and all of this will lead to التقوى, right? التقوى is the language of the Quran. Now you go a few verses down. هُدَى لِلْمُتَّقِينَ الَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْغَيْبِ وَيُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةَ. يؤمنون بالغيب is to believe in the unseen. الغيب is the unwitnessed, or the unseen. The Quran does not divide the world into physics and metaphysics, into something we can experiment on and something that is metaphysics beyond physics, so in the realm of religion and philosophy. This is a Greek division of existence. The Quran divides the existence into غيب and شهادة. The witnessed and the unwitnessed, or the unseen. But the unseen exists. Al-Jannah, Al-Nar, Al-Jinn, الملائكة النفس الروح. This exists, but it is unseen. So there is a difference between scientifically saying something doesn't exist because I cannot prove it, versus something that actually it exists, but I cannot see it. I cannot reach it. Maybe one day I will be able to judge a nafs or a ruh. Maybe one day I will be able to see a jinn or a malaika. Maybe one day I will be able to understand, let's say, the language of the ants and the birds and so on. But when Prophet Sulaiman talked to the ant, he's actually talking to a creature with consciousness and language and society and a lot of things. Until today, when I was in Waterloo back in those 90s, I studied a bit of neuroscience. Until today, neuroscience doesn't believe that ants and birds and animals have consciousness or have, you know, because they put the consciousness in the neural network of the brain and so on. It's very underdeveloped in terms of how the Quran describes consciousness. And when it says, وَمَا مِنْ دَابَةٍ فِي الْأَرْضِ وَلَا طَائِرٍ يَطِيرُ بِجَنَاحَيْهِ إِلَّا أُمَمٌ أَمْثَالُكُمْ. There is no animal that walks on earth or a bird, but nations like you, communities like you, أُمَمٌ أَمْثَالُكُمْ. That is very advanced. The Quran is not a book of science in the sense of giving you equations and charts and so on. But it gives you the, if you wish, the conceptual framework. It gives you the general worldview, what's called in that التصور, التصور الإسلامي, how you can build images in your mind and what kind of names are given to things, right? And these names are very important because they describe the reality. The Quran describes the reality. So page one after Al-Fatiha, Al-Taqwa, and then Al-Ghaib to describe another part of the reality. And then, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا سَوَاءٌ عَلَيْهِمْ أَأَنذَرْتَهُمْ أَمْ لَمْ تُنذِرْهُمْ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ. Allah, ختم الله على قلوبهم وعلى سمعهم وعلى أبصارهم غشاوة ولهم عذاب عظيم. So Allah is saying, subhanahu wa ta'ala, that those who are disbelievers, Allah has sealed their hearts. They could not hear the truth. They are not capable of hearing the truth. And they had the choice to do that, but they decided to reject. Kafaru, to kafara is to reject. Not like when we call somebody a kafir or a disbeliever, that person has to reject the belief. Because the Quran somewhere else said that Allah will not punish people unless he sends a messenger. So people in this part of the world, many of them might not know anything about Islam and might not have heard anything except for the media and so on. But that's not balagh. That is not risalah. That is people in this sense, they are considered ahlul fitra, the people of the nature. They are under nature. Or ahlul fatra, people between the messengers. They haven't heard. How can Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala punish them? But anyway, whoever is going to be punished, whoever is not, whoever is by the name Abdullah but is going to go to hell, and by the name John is going to go to Jannah, this is not our business. This is not what we can really judge. But we are judging the Quranic conceptual framework here. That الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا سَوَاءٌ عَلَيْهِمْ أَنذَرْتَهُمْ أَمْ لَمْ تُنذِرْهُمْ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ. People, you warn them and you give them the message and then they reject it. That is kuffar. That is. Because Allah then talks subhanahu wa ta'ala about another concept. قلوبهم. ختم الله على قلوبهم. Their hearts. Now, in the Islamic concept, in the Quranic concept, it is the heart that sees and not the eyes. فإنها لا تعمل أبصار ولكن تعمل قلوب التي في الصدور. It is the heart that remembers. It is the heart that decides. It is something in the heart. And if you have doubt that this heart is a metaphor for something, Allah said, the heart that is in the chest. Al-qulubu allati fi al-sudur. It's here. It's in your chest. Now, science is not there yet, discovering some of it. Now we hear that there is a memory for the heart and that. Oh, sure, that's good. But even if this science doesn't exist, now we know that our heart, this organ, is not just a machine. You cannot just replace it and put some other machine. and the other person is not dead and it's a mess. We can talk with the doctors about that. Where is Dr. Wael? I had a debate with him online over that a few months ago. But anyway, so basically, قلوبهم وعلى سمعهم وعلى أبصارهم غشاوة. And then the Quran is given some very interesting. ومن الناس من يقول آمنا بالله وباليوم الآخر وما هم بمؤمنين. This is page one. We're still on page one after the Fatiha. It's talking about what? Another very important concept that's called النفاق. We were just talking about it with brothers before the lecture. And we were mentioning all of these people in the Middle East. And I said, أخي, these are منافقون. These are, this is the, you know, Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul and so on of that current time. Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul, he prayed in the masjid and he stood behind the Prophet and everything. And he was a Muslim, but he wasn't. And then for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make this idea really clear in our minds, he went on from page 1 to page 3, just about the munafiqun. خَتَمَ اللَّهُ عَلَى قُلُوبِهِمْ وَعَلَى أَبْصَارِهِمْ غِشَاوَةٌ وَلَهُمْ عَذَابٌ عَظِيمٌ وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَقُولُ آمَنَّا بِاللَّهِ وَبِالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ وَمَا هُمْ مُؤْمِنُونَ يُخَادِعُونَ اللَّهَ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَمَا يَخْدَعُونَ فِي قُلُوبِهِمْ مَرَضٌ فَزَادَهُمُ اللَّهُ مَرَضًا وَإِذَا قِيلَ لَهُمْ لَا تُفْسِدُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ قَالُوا إِنَّمَا نَحْنُ مُصْلِحُونَ أَلَا إِنَّهُمُ الْمُفْسِدُونَ وَلَكِنْ لَا يَشْعُرُونَ إِذَا قِيلَ لَهُمْ آمِنُوا كَمَا آمَنَ النَّاسُ مَثَلُهُمْ كَمَثَلِ الَّذِي اسْتَوْقَدَ نَارًا فَلَمَّا أَضَاءَتْ مَا حَوْلَهُ He's talking about them for a couple pages. Why? Because المنافقون is a very important part of that worldview that you are drawing for yourself as you read the Quran. Before reading the Quran, or if you're not really reading the Quran, you don't have a definition for a munafiqun. Who are the munafiqun? And you don't really think that they exist. You think anybody with the name Abdurrahman or Abdullah or Muhammad is a Muslim. But the Quran is saying, no, they are not. They يَقُولُ وَالنَّاسُ مَنْ يَقُولُ آمَنَّا بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ وَمَا هُمْ بِمُؤْمِنِينَ They say, how do you know? وَإِذَا قِيلَ لَهُمْ لَا تُفْسِدُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ قَالُوا إِنَّمَا نَحْنُ مُصْلِحُونَ They are corrupting the earth. They are causing mischief. They are killing people by the, I don't know, whatever, millions in wars and so on, let's say. And they are causing all sorts of crimes to happen. But then we tell them, don't do mischief. They say, إِنَّمَا نَحْنُ مُصْلِحُونَ We are the reformers, right? So not anybody who says that they are doing reform are actually reformers. They could be munafiqun, but they are just using it. And the Quran is full of this. The Quran has about 1,000 verses on munafiqun, just munafiqun. Read Surah At-Tawbah. Most of it is actually about munafiqun. And then we have Surah Al-Munafiqun. إِذَا جَاءَكَ مُنَافِقُونَ قَالُوا نَشْهَدُ إِنَّكَ لَرَسُولُ اللَّهِ وَاللَّهِ يَعْلَمُ إِنَّكَ رَسُولُ وَاللَّهِ يَشْهَدُ إِنَّ مُنَافِقِينَ لَكَاذِبُونَ And Surah An-Nisa. إِنَّ مُنَافِقِينَ فِي الدَّرْكِ الْأَسْفَلِ مِنَ النَّارِ تَجِدُ لَهُمْ نَصِيرًا And so forth. It's a long story. That now, from page one, is telling you that to do reform, al-islah, or to do ifsad, or mischief, there's a criteria. Not anybody who does anything and says they are doing reform, or anybody, no. So the Quran is defining what is reform and what is mischief. As-salah wal-fasad. How do you measure that? How do you measure that this is salah or this is fasad? And the Quran talks about muslihun as a category and mufsidun as a category. And full of this, if you just scan the Quran for muslihun and mufsidun, it will be clear to you. And then the Quran, third page, we're still reading and you know trying to see what we missed. The third page, it's talking about Adam and the story. And so from the beginning, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is making sure that we have this history. Because history is very important. History is a major part of an identity. Now, you know, people who in social sciences will tell you that. People who study what's called identity today. A major part of identity is history. The other parts are language and religion or faith. These are three components. Now, the language itself, which is this Arabic, is actually the language of Islam. Yes, we speak English, and I'm speaking English, because this is our language here in Canada. But our conceptual framework has to be in Arabic, and has to be Iman, wa kufr, wa jannah, wa nar, wa munafiqun, wa zina, wa zawaj, وحرام وحلال و... and so forth. This is how it is. And these words are defined in a particular way. We cannot, after a couple thousand years, we come and define zina differently, and we define a different kind of family or whatever. This is not Islamic. How? Because the Quran defines family in a particular way and has a very clear way. This is not ambiguous or generic. It's very clear, very detailed, in fact. On these issues, the Quran is very detailed. So, and then what is haram is detailed, very clear. Now, so Adam, وَعَلَّمَ أَدَمَ الْأَسْمَاءَ كُلَّهَا. These are these concepts that we talk about. Al-asma are actually best translated as concepts rather than names, because names are a bit ambiguous. He taught Adam all what we call today in English would be concepts, or what we call in the Islamic thought al-mafahim or tasawurat, if you use a Quranic or an Islamic civilization kind of term, al-tasawurat. You know, how to imagine things, how to understand the world. You describe the world according to a framework. So Adam was taught that, and then Iblis did not like him, and the story is detailed in the other places. But then in that story, Al-Baqarah is actually talking about Adam only. It's not talking about Eve, you see. So when the Christians, or the Jews for that matter, believe that Eve gave Adam an apple, and therefore she is responsible for the original sin, and that is why Jesus came to sacrifice himself to give us freedom from the original sin, right? Like this, like a whole religion is built on this. But the Quran is not saying that Eve gave Adam anything. In fact, وَعَصَى آدَمُ رَبَّهُ فَغَوَى. It is Adam who made the sin. And Eve actually followed him. You know, poor thing, as usual, you know. She follows, and then he goes the wrong way. So that's what happened, right? But they repented together. قَالَ رَبَّنَا ظَلَمْنَا أَنفُسَنَا الْأَعْرَافِ. It's both of them. But it's never just Eve. And that is very important, because that is another part of that puzzle that will build a framework in your mind. We don't think that that the woman is responsible for the original sin. We have one hadith which is unfortunately narrated in the authentic books, where in which the Prophet ﷺ said, "لولا حواء لم تخن أنثى زوجها الدهر." If Hawa had not done what she had done, no woman would have betrayed her husband. So he's referring to the khiyana, or the betrayal of Hawa, of Eve, when she gave Adam the apple. But that is, according to scholars who are really like the higher level of scholars in Islam, this is Israeliyat. This is part of the Children of Israel narrations that found its way in our authentic collections. Again, it's not black and white, and authentic collections are mostly authentic, but there are things that go against the Quranic concept here. If we are going to say that Eve is responsible for Adam's sin, or that Eve did khiyana, where is this in the Quran? And where is this in the rest of the prophets saying? It's only that hadith that the scholars who are, you know, experts in that would say that no, this is Ka'b al-Ahbar, you know, one of the rabbis who became Muslim, and then he narrated a mixture of things, things in the Torah and things in Islam. So that was mixed with those narrations, and people in the second level mixed between him and another great companion who narrated other things, who is Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu. So they mixed Abu Huraira with Ka'b al-Ahbar, and they narrated this according to Abu Huraira. But it is really Ka'b al-Ahbar. Why? Because there are a few of them in that context that are against the Quran. Like the Muslim continues and says that Allah has created the heavens and earth in 7 days. مَسَكَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ بِيَدِهِ فَقَالَ خُلِقَتِ التُّرْبَةُ وَالسَّبْتُ, and so forth, until Friday. He didn't mention the Sabbath, but then they stopped here. But this is exactly line by line This is 7 days from the Torah. So Imam Bukhari, for example, one of the great scholars of hadith, and these hadith are in Muslim. He said, how can Muslim narrate this? Because Allah created heavens and earth in 6 days, not seven. So when the narration says seven, he should have rejected that. Yes, the narrators are authentic, but there is a higher criteria, which is the Quran, again. And Imam Bukhari, for this is not complicated. This is 6 verses 7. How can you count 7 days? And Allah said, خَلَقَ السَّمَوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضَ فِي سِتَّةِ أَيَامٍ, a million times in the Quran. You know. So how come? But then, that's another narration, where when Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, radiallahu anhu, and then he narrated that women were punished by the menses because of one of the women and the children of Israel who did something, you know, in their mosque, etc. And this is totally from the Bible. This is the biblical version of dealing with women in Islam, women, which is that that Allah punishes them with their natural cycles and all of that. But in Islam, we don't have that. We don't have لا تزر وازرة وزر أخرى. Somebody from the children of Israel made a crime, so Allah punished all women. And what about women before the children of Israel? They didn't have menses. Like, where is this hadith coming from? You see, so a few of them, obviously, but there are some narrations that shaped the collective culture that we developed over the centuries that are different from where the Quran is taking the Ummah in terms of its conceptual framework, in terms of defining the physical world versus the spiritual, men versus women. When we get into the issues of family and so on, you find some other funny things. Now, a few pages down, the Quran switches in an incredible way. They call it in the Ulum al-Quran, al-iltifat, or Ulum al-Balagha. Al-iltifat is the change of context. So there's a context, and then quickly there's a change of context. All of a sudden, out of nowhere, يَا بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلَ اذْكُرُوا نِعْمَتِيَ الَّتِي أَنْعَمْتُ عَلَيْكُمْ وَأَوْفُوا بِعَهْدِي أُوفِ بِعَهْدِكُمْ وَإِيَّايَ فَارْهَبُونَ. So all of a sudden, the context changes from talking about Adam and what happened and the shaitan and so forth, into talking about the children of Israel. And the wisdom here is for us not to fall in the same mistakes that the children of Israel had done. It's not just the story of the children of Israel that is given in the Quran. It is the meaning behind the story. There is about one quarter of the Quran on the children of Israel. There is about one quarter of the Quran on the children of Israel, really. And this is not just out of stories, entertainment. This is serious, because the children of Israel were the last people who carried the banner of Islam. Islam is not the religion of Muhammad, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. According to the Quran, Muhammad is a mujaddid, is somebody who is renovating, is reviving. But Islam is the religion of Adam. And Musa is a prophet of Islam, and Isa is a prophet of Islam from the children of Israel. Isa is not the prophet of Christianity. This is Islam. People can describe whatever they want, but I'm talking about the Quranic description of Islam, of Christianity, of Judaism. The Jews said, "Inna hudna ilayk," we are returning to you. Hudna, Yahud, in their language means we are going back to you, we are referring to you, something like labbaik Allahumma labbaik that we say. But so they called themselves Jews. And the Nasara, وَمِنَ الَّذِينَ قَالُوا إِنَّا نَصَارَى, they called themselves Nazarites. And then eventually Christians and so on with the Trinity, etc. But these are not different religions. This is Islam, but deviated. Now the Quran is speaking. The Quran is saying, well, they have Islam. They are actually required to fast as we fast and pray as we pray. And this is how they fasted and this is how they prayed originally. But then eventually they did what's called tahrif, or alteration. So fasting, instead of Ramadan, they started to do other times, and then eventually, okay, we're not going to eat, but we're going to drink. And then eventually, as churches are today, no, we can fast from chocolate, we can fast from meat. This is how they altered the ibadah. That is how we believe as Muslims. With all respect to the religion, and lakum dinukum waliya din, you have your religion. So there are religions, but originally, it is Islam. It's just Islam. So when you read the Quran, you are actually dealing with everybody as degrees of Muslims. But it depends on where they took this Islam. Some of them disbelieve. لَقَدْ كَفَرَ الَّذِينَ قَالُوا إِنَّ اللَّهَ وَالْمَسِيحَ ابْنُ مَرْيَمَ. Those who called Jesus the son of Mary Allah, they disbelieved. Now, this is clear here. But المسيح originally was a prophet of Islam. وَقَالَ الْمَسِيحُ يا بني إسرائيل عبد الله ربي ربكم إنه من يشرك بالله فقد حرم الله عليه الجنة وما للظالمين والأنصار فقد كفر الذين قالوا إن الله ثالث ثلاثة and so forth. But then the حواريين, the followers of Jesus said واشهد بأننا مسلمون, we are مسلمون, right? موسى صلى الله عليه وسلم يا قومي إن كنتم أمنتم بالله فعليه توكلوا إن كنتم مسلمين. We're talking about Islam here. That is a definition of Islam, and therefore when Allah talks about the children of Israel, He's talking about the previous followers of Islam who did not follow it because they did other things other than what Allah told them to do. Yet, some of them followed it because eventually Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لَيْسُ سَوَاءً. Now, in Al-Imran, they are not all the same. Okay. It's all right. Is he fasting? Oh, poor thing. So basically, okay, back to my point is that when we read the Quran, and I will have to stop and inshallah get in a few minutes. When we read the Quran, we are actually opening for ourselves a world that is different from how every thought defined the world. And I would venture to say, including the Islamic thought to a great extent. And therefore, it is important that we put the Quran as a criteria to judge our Islamic thought and our narrations and our whatever human thing that we do. And if they are compatible with it, then it's fine. If they are not, then they are subject to critique. Because the Quran is muhaiminan alayhi. It is sovereign over the previous books, and it is sovereign over our understanding, obviously. We cannot understand something that is different from what this book is saying, even in the language itself. You see, sometimes it's funny when you read in the tafsir of the Quran, and you find some of the mufassireen judging the language of the Quran with the language of the Arabs pre-Islam, the pre-Islamic Arabic, you know. So Sha'r al-Jahili. Yes, this is a correct structure from the Quran, because Zuhair ibn Abi Sulma said this, or al-Farazdaq, or whatever, like al-Farazdaq later. But anyway, you know, like, no, but it's supposed to be the Quran who is. I was reading the other day in one of the qira'at, قَالُوا إِنْ هَذَانِ لَسَاحِرَانِ. They are but two magicians, you know, Musa and Harun. And there is a qira'ah that says, قَالُوا إِنَّ هَذَانِ لَسَاحِرَانِ. Qira'ah sahihah. It's a correct reading of إِنَّ هَذَانِ. If you take Arabic, it's supposed to be إِنَّ هَذَيْنِ. If you do Sibawi, إِنَّ هَذَيْنِ لَسَاحِرَانِ, not إِنَّ هَذَانِ لَسَاحِرَانِ. And you find some, you know, silly people say, oh, okay, so see the Qur'an as grammatical mistake. It's إِنَّ هَذَانِ. It's supposed to be إِنَّ هَذَيْنِ. But no, إِنَّ هَذَانِ is actually also Arabic, because in Arabic proper, Quranic Arabic, and it's actually turned out to be the language of one of the tribes during the time of the Prophet ﷺ. But the Quran, because it is revealed in many ahruf, in many dialects, sometimes it is actually conforming with some of the sub-Arabic dialects. And some Arabs do not say hadain. They do not use the ya with the muthanna. They always use the alif. So inna hadani, fi hadan, not fi hadain. And that is, so what I'm saying is, it's not supposed to be Sibawayh who tells the Quran how to be. It is the Quran who is supposed to tell Sibawayh. So they say, well, you know, ba, this is za'ida, this is additional. The Quran doesn't have any za'id, any addition. Everything has a meaning. They say, well, jawab al-sharti mahdhuf wa taqdiru. So when you have a conditional statement, and the Quran doesn't give even the rest of the sentence. The Quran sometimes stops in the middle of the sentence. And this is part of the balagh al-arabiyya. This is part of the Arabic expression. Because you could stop in the middle of the sentence and let people imagine, you know, you see. وَسِيقَ الَّذِينَ تَقَوْ رَبَّهُمْ إِلَى الْجَنَّةِ زُمَرَةً حَتَّى إِذَا جَاءُوهَا وَفُتِحَتْ أَبْوَابُهَا وَقَالَ لَهُمْ خَزَنَتُهَا سلام. When they arrive and the doors are open and the angels will tell them, it's not telling you what will happen when they arrive. حَتَّى إِذَا جَاءُوهَا وَفُتِحَتْ. It's not إِذَا جَاءُوهَا فُتِحَتْ أَبْوَابُهَا. This is would be the rest of the sentence. But the rest of the sentence is not there. حتى إذا جاءوها وفتحت أبوابها وقال لهم خزنتها سلام عليكم طبتم فتقولوا خالدين. Then what will happen is actually left for you to imagine what will happen. You see, so sometimes it's not the Arabic theory that is going to judge the structure of the Quran. It is actually the Quran that will structure the Arabic theory. And similarly, it is not our political theory or economic theory or whatever little psychological theory that somebody had put that will judge how the Quran deals with the human consciousness and deals with societies and so on. It is actually the other way around. It is a duty on us to read the Quran. And when we have a tour in the Quran, when we go from the beginning to the end, we complete one tour in the Quran, alhamdulillah, it will actually explain a lot. It starts by Bani Israel, and then by the end of the Quran, you will know enough about Bani Israel, and you will know enough about Ad-Din, Wa-Shari'a, Wa-Shura, and so forth. So many forms in the form of a story, and the similes, Al-Amthal, and Al-Qasas, and so forth, and Al-Jannah, Al-Nar. And by the end of the Quran, you will have quite a good picture of Islam. But then, when you go back to the Quran, and do what's called at-tadabbur. At-tadabbur is to reflect upon something after it passes. You know, so the Quran passes, and then you go back, and then reflect upon it again. You will start to link things differently, because by the end of the Quran, you will have quite a good picture. And then when you go back from al-Fatiha and you start to read al-Baqarah again, and you say, oh, okay, so now he's talking about the munafiqeen, that he in Surah al-Tawbah said this and that, and then eventually in Surah Al-Munafiqun, he said this and that. Oh, okay. And then he talks about Al-Qalb and Al-Jannah and Nar and so forth. So as you read, and every time you take a cycle in the Quran, the reflection cycles will open up meanings and will shape your perception of the world and will shape your behavior and your heart and your mind in a particular way. That is the way we should celebrate the month of the Quran, not by getting lost really in all of the, you know, occasional questions about the moon and so forth and the new moon. Well, Allah said in the Quran, يسألونك عن الأهلة قل هي مواقيت للناس والحج. They ask you about the new moon. Say they are مواقيت. مواقيت means ميقات, is a timing. They are the timing. Why? Because we're not supposed to, you know, break our fast in the beginning of Ramadan. And we're not supposed to fast in the beginning of Shawwal. That's it. Like, it's not really, it's like, قُلْ هِيَ مَوَقِيتُ لِلنَّاسِ وَالْحَجِ وَلَيْسَ الْبِرَّ مَنْ تَأْتُوا الْبِيُوتَ مِنْ ظُهُرِيَا وَلَكِنَّ الْبِرَّ مَنْ اتَّقَى وَأَتُوا الْبِيُوتَ مِنْ أَبْوَابِهَا. He is saying, don't get stuck with, you know, these things were to enter the door. It's not about that. This is not an ibadah to go inside the moon and so on. It's actually, to me, and you know, I'm a member of a few councils, alhamdulillah, none of the councils of which I'm a member, they go and in the desert and look for the moon. I mean, they all calculate whether here in the ISNA Council, the European Council, and the Indian Council. But otherwise, let me say it's a shame, really, that we are still going out in the desert and looking for the moon. What is this? يَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنْ الْأَهِلَّةِ قُلْ هِيَ مَوَاقِيتُ صُومُوا لِرُؤْيَتِهِ وَالنَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ سَدَّ رُؤْيَتِهِ مَنْ رَأَى مِنْكُمْ مُنْكَرًا فَلْيُغَيِّرْهُ. It's not about seeing. What is this? This is very poor Arabic. When we say رُؤْيَتِهِ means to go and see. Yes, of course, they had to go and see until 100 years ago. But now we can calculate. We have a calendar, you know, and it's very interesting how this is part of the Muslim culture and the Muslim debate and how it wastes the first few days of Ramadan, the first few days of Eid, over calculating when Shawwal is. And we know when Shawwal is for the next 1,000 years. So that is an example of getting lost in something away from the clear path of the Quran. يَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنْ الْأَهِلَّةِ قُلْ هِيَ مَوَاقِيتُ لِلنَّاسِ وَالْحَجِّ. Yes, the Bedouin in Arabia who wants to know, they can go out in the desert and see. And if I'm in by myself in the desert, I don't have communication, I'll go out and see. But if I can communicate and if I can calculate, and yes, there is an error, but it's better to have an error of one of a millionth versus an error of 50% when you go and look, or an error, I mean, you know, every few years we have an error, really, in those countries that go and make people go out in the desert and look for the moon. So another example of how we could read the Quran. So I hope that this introduction gives fairness to the topic, just sharing some thoughts. And I hope, inshallah, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes this month really a way of us acquiring taqwa, like real taqwa, in the way the Quran described it. It's very multifaceted and very difficult to achieve. But with Allah's help, nothing is difficult. Alhamdulillah. Jazakumullah khair.
Allah jazakumullah khair. You can continue the recording. We'll have a couple of questions
sure.
And answers.
Sure.
From if anyone has questions.
Yeah, comments, corrections. Comments. Don't mind, please. Yeah, yes. Oh, I choose? Okay. Okay. I go with the system.
JazakAllah khair. It's amazing to reinforce the fact that tafsir, when we're reading, is so important. And we get so lost, many of us, in the khatma and the speed of reading the Quran multiple times. And a lot of times we don't spend, throughout the whole year, I find that we're all concentrated on the Quran in Ramadan. And even the rest of the year, we're not doing tafsir. So this is just kind of reinforcing the fact that tafsir is so important. You can read it over and over and over and still not understand. For spending that time in actually understanding what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is trying to tell us is so important.
Jazakallah khair. Allah, I was reading yesterday, وَالَّذِينَ إِذَا ذُكِّرُوا بِآيَاتِ رَبِّهِمْ لَمْ يَخِرُّوا عَلَيْهَا صُمًّا وَعُمْيَانًا. Those who are reminded of the verses. Ayah is not really a verse, like wallahi, but it has to be an ayah. But let's say verses of Allah, the signs. Translated as signs. Those who are reminded of the signs of Allah, they deal with it as if they are deaf and blind. And I felt sometimes, because, you know, sometimes when you have a word and you want to go through it, and I'm guilty of that for sure, I cannot deny it, you really want to finish your word because of the memorization. And the memorization is also part of the tafakkur, the dirasa, you know. But it shouldn't be just what we do with the Quran. Because it's much more important to be fahim than to be a hafiz, really. We have glorified the hafiz in a way much more than the fahim. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had said in the hadith as well, in addition to the Quran, that the hafiz is like a stone that keeps the water. But the fahim, مثل ما بعثني له, the hadith, مثل ما بعثني له من العلم كمثل أرض فيها قيعان. It's like a land with three pieces. One piece is rocky and it keeps the water. This is somebody who does hifz. And another piece that doesn't keep the water and doesn't plant anything. So it's like sandy. This is somebody who reads and doesn't memorize and doesn't understand. And then he says about the third piece of water, which piece of land, in which the water comes down, so فأنبتت العشبة والكلى. So it, so الفهم is more important than الحفظ. And we should really make sure that those who memorize the Quran, they memorize it for the sake of الفهم, for the sake of, when we used to memorize when we were kids, I mean the Shaykh would start from the middle of the verse, the middle of the word sometime, you know, just to make sure that you memorize very well, you see. But I don't remember, and Allah yarhamu, Shaykh, great Shaykh and everything, but I never remember him saying, you know what, stop here. What is this about? Do you understand what this means? Or any of that. We just memorize. We're just adding a copy in our computers. So we need to shift from this culture so that at least the Hifz has a general understanding of the surah. So at least, yes, you can memorize the Quran and you don't know Arabic, but at least know that Al-Fatiha is about this and this is about that. At least. Allah a'lam. Akhi Ahmad.
I'd like to elaborate, if you can, on the concept that you started with, saying post-14 history, that a lot of our concepts were based on secular versus Quranic understandings, and that, so that's part one. And part two, why do you think that happened? Is it inevitable, or was there, knowing that those people were the closest to the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, why were they so susceptible to being that?
Well, 40 Hijri is the time, basically in my reading of the history, when the Khilafah ended by Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu, and we entered into a phase of kingdom, al-mulk. I don't want to get into the issue itself of Ali radiallahu anhu and Muawiyah and so on. I don't want to get into this issue because of a simple fact that I don't know. The history is lost. After reading a lot in this area, I can tell you the history is lost. Because the ahadith that that praise Muawiyah as a sahabi, Hadi and Mahdiya, are as authentic as the other ahadith. إِذَا رَأَيْتُمْ هَذَا عَلَى هَذِي الْأَعْوَادِ فَاقْتُلُوا. It's the same chains, really. So it's a lost history. In terms of who was believer and who was this and that. But it's not a lost history in terms of what happened in the Ummah on a, let's say, a political level. When the Khilafah was transformed into a kingdom, the Malullah, the fortune, the Baytul Mal. You see, Sayyidina Umar and Sayyidina Abu Bakr and so forth, and Sayyidina Uthman was rich, he didn't need any of that, and Sayyidina Ali, they took from Baytul Mal a salary. And then they used Baytul Mal for what the Ummah agrees on, you know, when they divide. Baytul Mal was used differently from that time on, in the sense that those who paid allegiance to the kingdom, they got salaries, and they got even sometimes more than the salaries, like a little castle or whatever. And those who do not pay allegiance, they had less salaries, or they were basically put to hunger. When you read about a number of the companions at that time who rejected, especially a few years on, the transformation of the kingdom into a hereditary kingdom. As Imam Hussein radiallahu anhu said, جَعَلْتُمُوهَا قَيْصَرِيًا كُلَّمَا مَاتَ قَيْصَرْ جَاءَ قَيْصَرْ. You made it like a Caesarism. Every Caesar who dies, another Caesar comes. So from that time, Imam Hussein was hungry, and they would, I mean, his cousins would collect money for him. Why didn't he get the allowance? It's because he was on the opposing side. Now, that history is really, really lost in the narrations and the conflict. I really cannot really tell everything about it. But what I can tell is that fiqh shrank from being about everything in the public arena into being about mostly the ibadat. And the public affairs were run according to the allegiances with the different governments. Of course, eventually with the Umayyads, not all of them were bad. You have Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, you have Muawiyah Thani, you have a number of the second Muawiyah, you have a number of Khulafa, who were really Khulafa, who all of them actually started their Khilafa by saying, I am no longer your Khalifa, I am not chosen by you, so you choose for yourself. So that's how they chose Umar ibn Abdul Aziz again, and Muawiyah Thani, the grandson of Muawiyah, the son of Yazid, and so on. They started by saying, I am not chosen according to you, at least the people of Medina, so choose. So they choose him. That is a very different Khalifa from the Khalifas who, you know, eventually said, you know, من قال لي اتق الله ضربت عنقه, you know, the what's his name? I guess, what was that? Was it Marwan ibn al-Hakam? Like, that's a very different Khalifa, you know. If you say to me, اتق الله, I will kill you, you know. But Umar and Abu Bakr, they didn't do that. They said, وليت عليكم ولست بخيركم. Of course, Abu Bakr. وليت عليكم ولست بخيركم. So, my understanding of our history is that that shift to the kingdom had changed many things. Many other things continued, you know. Don't get me wrong, it was not a total, you know, mischief and so on. Many other facets, we have evidence that they continued to flourish. But the deviation that happened in terms of the role of Islam in public life, and especially the distribution of wealth in the Ummah, that started quite early. And it is quite costly to say that, because most of, you know, scholars would take quite a stand from that. And you will find that, you know, some people of ignorance would say, oh, so you're Shia, because you're not. No, you know, I'm talking about even before the Sunnah and Shia developed. We're not supposed to define ourselves this way anyway. Now, here in Canada, in today, we're not supposed to belong to that. Who cares about that? We're Muslims and that's it. But anyway, so no, it's not about that. And Shiaism in terms of bid'ah developed much later than that. And of course it developed as a sect with a lot of bid'ah, and Mu'tazilis developed as a sect, and what's called the Jama'ah or Ahl Sunnah developed as a sect, and Al-Asha'ira have bid'ahs, and the Mu'tazila have bid'ahs, and the Shia have bid'ahs. Everybody has their own bid'ahs, but it depends on how you assess it, you know. And every student of knowledge would know that there are things that are unacceptable in every madhab. And every scholar who gets into these areas would have critical views about every madhab. But you know what, today we don't need the Mu'tazila and the Sha'ira and the Maturidiyya and the Sunnah and the Shia. We don't have any of that because, yes, of course, the Middle East is full of that. But let's talk about here for now. And it's a purely political game, by the way, over there. But let's talk about here now. No, we need to go against not the tajsim wa ta'til wa ta'wil wa al-tashbih wa al-istighatha. No. We need to go against Darwinism and atheism and positivism and materialism. And we have so many madhahib today that we need to take a stand from, you see. And this is how we should do knowledge today, according to the questions of today and the problems of today in terms of faith and in terms of fiqh, in terms of aqidah, in terms of fiqh. The question of aqidah today is not whether to do ta'wil or not to do ta'wil, the difference between the Asha'ira and the Mu'tazila. You could be any of that, but it's a very serious question, how to answer atheism and how to deal with Darwinism now that we teach it in our schools. And how to, you know, these are very serious questions. But we haven't done that because Ahlul Kalam, or the people who are busy with the philosophy of Islam, are not dealing with Darwinism. And so they're not capable. They didn't study physics. They didn't study biology. They don't understand. They studied Sharia. And what they studied qualifies them to debate in the past, not in the present. And that is a problem, because how can we defend Islam now from all of the questions of atheism that we have and so forth, if we don't study atheism properly and see where these people are coming from and how we can defend Islam. And that's how Al-Imam Al-Ash'ari and the Mu'tazila and Qadi Abdul Jabbar, all of these were defenders of Islam, but were defenders of Islam from other questions that we no longer have. And sometimes we manufacture questions, you know, like in Arabia or today, we manufacture an issue and then we this is Jahmiyyah and this is Safavi. And all of this is history. Today, we have different scenes. So Allah alam, yeah.
Jazakallah khair. I think we'll have to close here.
Oh yeah, okay. Sorry for taking longer than I see a few hands.
No, we have the babysitters finish at 8, so we're
gonna have
a lot of crazy kids.
We're gonna have a flood here.
Okay, so now we're gonna have to close.
No, we have to close and then play with them, inshallah, rather than silence them. Jazakallah khair. Tomorrow we have more sessions here in the masjid.
So tomorrow at 10 o'clock we have a session with Dr. Jasser, who is going to be addressing the issue of Islamic thought versus deeds in Islamic thought.